Listening Library presents Watched by Marina Budhos. Read for you by Sunil Malhotra. Part 1. The Suit. File. Subject. Rashid Ahmed, Owner, Star Travel Agency. Address. 35th Avenue, Suite 211, Jackson Heights, New York, 11372. Date of birth, redacted. Social Security number, redacted. Mosque, Al-Nur Masjid. Op number 293 spoke to Abdul Rahman, leasee of store below Star Travel Agency. Rahman's country of origin is Bangladesh. Appeared nervous when asked about neighbor upstairs. Confirmed after-hours activity. Claims little affiliation. He is aware that the travel agency accepts cash for tickets, and he does sometimes hold payments and packages in his store when the agency is closed. Plan of action. Re-interview downstairs tenant. Continue mail cover. Ascertain whether use of cash is common for tickets bought to South Asia and other overseas destinations. Subpoena phone records and submit for analysis. Continue surveillance. Chapter 1. I'm watched. There's a streetlight near my parents' store, and I hear the click, a shutter snapping as I round the corner. My gaze swivels up, but there's nothing. Just a wide-eyed orb, a lamp, ticking, the dim sky floating behind. I shiver, tell myself it's all in my head. Nothing. Click. Click. Hunching my shoulders, I hurry down 37th Avenue, the sweat warm against my sweatshirt hood. Past the thin shed of a shop with glittery bangles and cheap plastic frogs swimming in plastic tubs. Past Mr. Rahman's table of beads hung on metal hooks, folded prayer rugs, and little engraved Qurans. He, along with the other uncles who stand on the street, scans me, disapproving. They know. I'm up to no good. I'm not working in my parents' little store, as I should be. I did spend most of the afternoon there, my stepmother hovering by the cash register, pretending to tally the day's earnings. But really, she was grazing me like a worried searchlight, her pencil tapping the side of the register. I know that look. I see you. Usually when it isn't busy in the store and I finish tying up the old newspapers and moving around the milk cartons, I sit on a crate in the back, next to the humming refrigerator, textbook balanced on my knees. But today, it was hard to focus. My brain danced. I got antsy, thinking of where I'd rather be. The store was quiet, only one customer, a Deshi guy, tweed jacket, jeans, blowing on his Starbucks coffee. He comes in a lot. "You have post-its?" he asked. My stepmother shook her head. Disappointed, he bought some Tic Tacs. Then my phone vibrated against my thigh. I always keep it on silent when I'm in my parents' store. "Meet me at the mall, 4:30, Ibrahim texted. "Urgent." It's always urgent with Ibrahim. Slamming the book shut, I jerked up from the crate. My concentration was shot. Whenever I hear from Ibrahim, it's like a bowling ball cracking into the pins in my head, all my thoughts toppling over. There's no hope of picking my way through pre-cal equations. "Hey, Ma," I said this shyly, the way it always is between us. "I gotta go. Anything more you need?" She glanced at me, alarmed. The eraser on her pencil did a little bob. "What about studying?" "That's what I'm going to do," I lied. "Meet a friend. We've got pre-cal finals coming up." Here, her expression went sad, wistful.
"Calculus. Yes," she sighed. "When I was in high school, I am getting 85 in this subject."
I feel bad for Amma. I call her Amma, as if she is my own mother, not my stepmom. She's always speaking English with me, not Bangla, trying to show how she was almost like an American-born, going all the way through 12th grade, until her parents arranged a marriage to my father. I knew Amma just wanted me to keep her company, but I couldn't help myself. I needed to get out of that little gloomy corner, everything so dusty and sad. Even the lottery ticket flyer, the only reason folks come in here, is peeling off the wall. The boxes of sugar cubes that have sat on the shelf since the store opened up. Abba, who buys sugar cubes? I want to shout. He's lost track of what they're doing with this place. It kills me, seeing all the customers hurry into the store across the street. The one that has the fresh new awning and fancy lettering, plastic chairs outside, and is always changing its stock, offering discounts. Or their friends who have gotten together and opened a food mart with huge fish tanks and a halal butcher.
They have capital, my stepmother sighs. We have nothing.
Wait, I am showing you my outfit? I shot her a puzzled look. For graduation. I shook my head. Ma, it's 6 weeks away.
No matter. Shop is having sale.
She bustled to the back of the store, where she'd hung a shalwar kameez on a hook on the back of the door, then brought it to the front, spreading the rustling plastic across the counter.
See? She said proudly. I even have it dry cleaned, so it is all ready.
This made me sad and angry too. Amma saved every bit of extra money, 50 cents here, a dollar from the groceries, stowing it in her empty tin of Darjeeling tea leaves. The outfit was beautiful. Sea green with blue beads dangling from the yoke like ice drops. But half the reason she was making such a big deal over this was because of me, and half because of her. All she gave up to marry my father.
That's really nice, Ma. And your father? He is inviting many people to celebrate.
We both looked through the window, where we could see my father standing just outside the store, under the awning. His hands were tucked at the small of his back, his stomach pushed forward. More and more, that's all he does. Opens the store, puts away the Snapple bottles and milk cartons, and then leaves the rest to Amma. He sighs. He walks the pavement. Chats with the other shopkeepers. Complains about his bad knee. Mostly, he stares off at the rooftops, as if trying to glimpse something just beyond that escapes him. The watching. It seeps into everything in our neighborhood. It's like weather, the barometric pressure lowering. Before the monsoons came in Bangladesh, you could feel the air thicken and squat on your head, a constant ache behind your eyeballs. For the past few years, there's been another kind of pressure, a vibration around us, the air pressing down, muffling our mouths. We see the men coming down the metal stairs from the elevated subway or parked in cars for hours on end. Clean-cut guys, creased khakis, rolled-up sleeves, the breath of Manhattan steaming off their clothes. They aren't from around here. That we can tell. Not like the young couples with their big padded strollers, or the girls with pea coats and holes in their black tights who move to the nice part of Jackson Heights, carry yoga mats and cloth bags from stores I've never heard of. No, these people are different. They stroll into stores, finger the edges of the newspapers in their racks, check out flyers taped to the side of the fridge. One day, two of them came into my parents' store, pretended to buy some gum, and then asked a few questions about the travel agency upstairs. Where is the man who runs the place? Mr. Ahmed? How often does he come in? Does he stay after hours? Abba shook his head.
I do not watch my neighbor so much. He is from Pakistan. That is all I know.
Yet you hold packages for him?
Yes. But that is because they are not open all the time. It is favor.
The man consulted a tiny notebook. You attend the same mosque, Al Nur Masjid? At this, Abba froze, fingers resting light on the register, staring at the door.
No, we are praying at different place.
It hurt my heart, hearing this.
Abba's English, when he spoke to strangers, was halting, yet proper. He'd studied some English in Bangladesh.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.